Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to another wonderful solo run edition of Dangerous Ideas. Today, we are going to stay pretty factual. And the dangerous ideas, not so much what we think, as our opinion and editorial on various entertainment stuff, but rather how dangerous it can be for companies when there is a questionable idea about legal ownership. Yes, folks, we're going to talk about, in celebration of the recently debuted Godzilla King of the Monsters movie, and it being the final step in Legendary Pictures' build-up to King Kong vs. Godzilla, we're going to talk about King Kong and the fact that since basically step one, nobody's really known who King Kong belongs to. Unfortunately, as an idea, as a abstract, ethereal concept, which any story ultimately is, it's not a simple matter of saying, well, I'm physically holding it, and I have for a long time, so I must be the owner. You can't say possession is 9/10 of the law when there's no concrete object at the core of the debate. So, we're going to run through this real quick, partly because I do not have any formal law training, so I'm not able to get into a lot of the legal jargon and minutiae of the various court cases we're going to be discussing, partly because, well, like with all the times where I lay out some just flat-out facts for you, what I'm doing is giving you the Cliff Notes version to encourage you to go out and further educate yourself and read up more on various things. I want you to take the journey for yourself, not just the guided tour I provide. So, in the beginning, King Kong was created by Marion C. Cooper, who, being a bit of an adventurous sort himself, came up with the idea of, well, what if there was some isolated location time forgot where creatures of history and myth still existed? And from there, hey, a bit of a fascination with primates made him decide that at the top of the food chain, you would have the greatest of all primates, Kong, king of his island, thus King Kong. Now, he of course conceived this in 1929, but because Marion C. Cooper did not in fact really own any businesses himself with which he could take his idea and spread it out to the world, he licensed the character to RKO for the initial King Kong film and its direct sequel, with the understanding that he otherwise owned the creation. Flash forward several years, and Mr. Cooper there noticed that when he tried to get a Tarzan versus King Kong project off the ground for Pioneer Pictures, a different studio than RKO, which had done the initial King Kong movie and its sequel, RKO actually brought up some legal objections. Which made Cooper have to stop and think things through and do a little legal research. which, you know, took a long time. In fact, it took a few decades. Because, as we're going to discuss later, documentation was never Marion C. Cooper's strongest, strength. In 1962, Cooper found out that RKO had decided to license the King Kong character to Toho Studios in Japan for a little film project called King Kong vs. Godzilla, which I'm happy to say I own on DVD. No, I do not have a complete Godzilla collection. I really only have maybe about a fifth of the total Godzilla movies. A little less. But I do have King Kong vs. Godzilla, and I do have the original Godzilla in both its American format and the original Japanese Gojira, which are highlights of my collection. Best of all, I got those two movies as part of a double set. So none of this, like, cheap bootleg public domain nonsense you often get with copies of Night of the Living Dead, which is a whole nother legal discussion that I may cover in the future if I don't get feedback that say these legal entertainment things are totally bullcrap and nobody cares. But anyway, as I said, we're focusing today on King Kong. So, Cooper once again assumed that his rights kind of kept people from just freely putting King Kong whatever movie they want, and bitterly opposed the project. In 1963, he filed a lawsuit to enjoin distribution of the movie against the liaison between the studios, John Beck, as well as Toho and Universal, who was going to have the copyright and U.S. distribution over the film. Cooper, during this whole legal moral lawsuit, discovered that RKO had also profited from licensed projects featuring the King Kong characters, such as Model Kits, and that Cooper was not only not involved in saying, yeah, that's, you know, something as King Kong's creator that I would be cool with, but wasn't getting any part of the profits either. So we got into a pretty hardcore lawsuit here, and Cooper and his legal team offered up various documents to bolster the case that Cooper owned King Kong and had only licensed the character to RKO for two films rather than selling him outright. Many people vouched for Cooper's claims, including David Selznick, who had written a letter to Mr. Lowenthal of the famous artist syndicate in Chicago in 1932, stating the rights of this are owned by Mr. Marion C. Cooper. Unfortunately, as I said, paperwork wasn't exactly Cooper's bread and butter. He had lost key documents through the years, partly due to the fact that Cooper did serve in World War II, and as such, was not home to keep close eye on his personal possessions. One of these documents was an informal yet binding letter from the then president of the RKO studio, and a letter from the then current president of RKO studio, at the current as of the time of the lawsuit, or at least the beginning of the lawsuit, that Cooper had only licensed the rights to the character for the two RKO pictures and nothing more. So without these letters, it looked like the best Cooper could hope for is having the copyright to the novelization of the original King Kong film, which through that he was able to make a deal for paperback reprints and a gold key comic adaptation of the novel. Cooper's lawyers later received a letter from John Beck's lawyer that stated, For the sake of the record, I wish to state that I am not in negotiation with you or anyone else to find Mr. Cooper's rights in respect of King Kong. His rights are well defined, and they are non-existent except for certain limited publication rights. Now, that was all that was said and done for King Kong for a little over a decade, when in 1975, Universal Studios and Dino De Laurentiis, who himself has a pretty interesting history in the movie industry, were fighting over who would be able to do a King Kong remake for release the following year. De Laurentiis came up with $200,000 to buy the remake rights from RKO. When Universal got wind of this, they filed a lawsuit against RKO, claiming they had a verbal agreement from them regarding the remake. During the legal battles that followed, which eventually included RKO countersuing Universal, as well as De Laurentiis filing a lawsuit claiming interference, Marion Cooper's son, Colonel Richard Cooper, who, following Marion's passing, was now head of the Cooper estate, jumped into the fray. Here's where it gets really complicated, folks, so please bear with me. This is also where it gets really fun. During the battles, Universal discovered that the copyright of the Lovelace novelization of the movie had expired without renewal, thus making the King Kong story a public domain one. Universal argued that they should be able to make a movie based on the novel without infringing on anyone's copyrights because the characters in that story were in the public domain within the context of the legal concept of public domain. Yeah, folks, this is what happens when you don't rehearse and write out a script for yourself. But, hey, I always promise to keep it real and raw with you folks. So, Richard Cooper then filed a cross-claim against RKO, claiming all the publishing rights to the novel had not been renewed, his estate still had control over the plot story of King Kong itself. In a four-day bench trial in Los Angeles, Judge Manuel Real made the final decision and gave his verdict on November 24, 1976, affirming that the King Kong novelization and serialization were indeed in the public domain and Universal could make its movie as long as it did not infringe on original elements in the 1933 RKO film, which had not passed into public domain and had different key plot points from the original novelization. Universal themselves then postponed their plans to film a King Kong movie called The Legend of King Kong for at least 18 months after cutting a deal with De Laurentiis that included a percentage of box office profits from his remake. This is why, folks, if you watch the 70s remake of King Kong and the original 30s version of King Kong, there are, as I said, key plot point differences, including, most infamously, the building that Kong climbs, leading to his fatal fall. Because, legally, the remake could not be a direct point-for-point remake of the 30s film. So on December 6, 1976, Judge Real made a subsequent ruling to help clarify the original ruling and everything that was being disputed that held that all rights in the name, character, and story of King Kong outside of the original film and its sequel belonged to Marion C. Cooper's estate. This ruling, which became known as the Cooper Judgment, expressly stated that it would not change the previous ruling that publishing rights of the novel and serialization were in the public domain. It was a huge victory that affirmed the position Marion C. Cooper had maintained for years, that as the original creator, he had never intended to outright sell King Kong to RKO, and he ultimately should have always been considered the creator and thus core owner of King Kong. Shortly thereafter, Richard Cooper sold all his rights, excluding worldwide book and periodical publishing rights, to Universal in December 1976. In 1980, Judge Real dismissed the claims that were brought forth by RKO and Universal 4 years earlier, which would have basically made the Cooper judgment null and void. So, keep this in mind, folks. 1976, I mean, right at the end of 76, might as well call it 77. Universal is told flat out in court they only own the rights to the original movie and its direct sequel. Keep this in mind, because Universal's about to make a huge mistake. 5 years later, in 1982, Universal files a lawsuit against then tiny upstart arcade entertainment company Nintendo over the character of Donkey Kong that had debuted in 1981 and became an instant hit, reaping huge profits for Nintendo and giving them the money they needed to continue making subsequent unrelated arcade games, and most importantly, allow them to pay computer engineers to design their home video game console that would become known here in America as the Nintendo Entertainment System, which of course would start off the great Mario era and Nintendo basically reviving the video game industry, which would probably be a 2-hour video for me to explain. However, between the NES being released and Donkey Kong coming out, as I said, we had this lawsuit from Universal, because Universal claimed Nintendo was infringing on its copyright because Donkey Kong was a blatant ripoff of King Kong, i.e. Nintendo was trying to make a King Kong game without giving Universal any of the money. Now, the bare bones of this, as I say, because we are doing the Cliff Note version, is that during the court battle and subsequent appeal, the courts ruled Universal did not have exclusive trademark rights to the King Kong character due to the earlier Cooper judgment. And that because that trademark was not among the rights Cooper had sold to Universal, this being, as we said earlier, Richard Cooper, the son of the original Marion, and the then head of Cooper Estate, indicating that Cooper plainly did not obtain any trademark rights in his judgment against RKO, since California District Court specifically found that King Kong had no secondary meaning. Which means that Universal, who, besides the rights that they got from Marion C. Cooper, had also purchased RKO Studios due to them, well, going through a period where they weren't making a lot of big money movies, as happens in business. So, while they did have a majority of the rights, they did not outright own the King Kong name and character. Remember, because throughout all of this, folks, the original King Kong novelization is still stood in public domain. Courts ruled noted that the name, title, and character of Kong no longer signified a single source of origin, so exclusive trademark rights were impossible. Courts also pointed out that the Kong rights were held by three parties. RKO owned the rights to the original film and its sequel, which I said eventually Universal bought the distribution rights for when RKO had some problems with their money. The Dino De Laurentiis Company, often shorthanded DDL, owned the rights to the 1976 remake. And Richard Cooper, as head of the Cooper Estate, owned worldwide book and periodical publishing rights. The judge ruled then that Universal thus only owns those rights in the King Kong name and character that RKO, Cooper, or DDL do not know. Court of Appeals, because of course Universal appealed this, took Universal to task because they said due to the fact it had only been 5 years since the Cooper judgment, that Universal knew it did not have trademark rights to King Kong at this level, yet proceeded to broadly assert such rights anyway, amounting to a wanton and reckless disregard of Nintendo's rights, not to mention all of the companies that were getting involved with home ports of Donkey Kong, as well as Donkey Kong merchandise that Universal also went after. And secondly, Universal did not stop after it asserted its rights to Nintendo and embarked on a deliberate, systematic campaign to coerce all Nintendo's third-party licensees, the ones I just mentioned, to either stop marketing Donkey Kong products or pay Universal royalties. This amounts to an abuse of judicial process, and in that sense caused a longer harm to the public as a whole. Essentially, what this boils down to, if you want to remove all legal jargon, is Universal knew that this whole lawsuit was BS, but were relying on the fact that they were a major corporation with a lot more money to survive a long-running lawsuit process to, even though they were in the wrong, basically win just by dragging things out to the point nobody else could afford to fight Universal. Which, you know, the court system really tends to get pissed off about, because that's, like, literally the worst abuse of the civil lawsuit system there is. When you know you're wrong, but you do it anyway, relying on the fact that your opponents are going to run out of time and money to fight you, and thus give in just so they can move on with their life. So, that meant Universal not only lost the court case, they had to pay money to Nintendo, which further fueled their budget for developing the NES. Whoopsie! This court case is known, for those who do want to do further reading, as Universal City Studios Inc. versus Nintendo Co. Limited. Now, since that court case, Universal still retains the majority of the character rights. In 1986, they opened up a King Kong ride called King Kong Encounter at the Universal Studios theme park in Hollywood, and followed it up with the Kongfrontation ride at the Orlando park in 1990. Both rides have since ceased functioning due to various issues. In fact, in Orlando, Kongfrontation has been repurposed and retooled as a mummy ride, as in the Brendan Fraser series of movies, and is actually quite excellent. They also made a King Kong remake film of their own in 2005, this being the one created by Peter Jackson that fans tend to either love or hate. I've seen it. I feel that they were on the right path in a lot of ways, but the new scenes they added to the story made the mistake of humanizing King Kong more than is necessary. Yes, King Kong is supposed to be a tragic figure in the sense of he was forcibly removed from where he was happy, to a alien world where he was treated as a sideshow freak, and the little positive he found about it, in this case the beautiful woman who was there at the island when Kong was taken, ended up killing him. So, jump forward to 2013, when Legendary Pictures reaches an agreement with Universal in which it will market, co-finance, and distribute Legendary's films for 5 years, starting in 2014, which was the year that Legendary's distribution agreement with Warner Brothers was set to expire. And the first major film of this is the King Kong origin film that is now known as Kong Skull Island. And it is a wonderful film if you've never seen it. But, sticking on the legal front, this is the key. that Legendary Pictures, Skull Island, and the next movie in their series that will be out in the next year or two, King Kong vs. Godzilla, is not 100% owned by Legendary. Legendary did not buy the Kong rights from Universal. Legendary basically made a deal that said, look guys, we'll make new King Kong films for you so you don't have to make them. And you'll get a chunk of the profits, but you have to help us with the distribution work. Which, honestly, is a great deal. That is the entertainment industry working at its best. When a small company has a great idea, and the bigger company says, yeah, sure, we'll help you with the system we've set up, because we are an older, bigger company, you know, we'll just take a little chunk off the top. However, here's the amusing part when it comes to the Legendary Universe. You see, Legendary Pictures had also taken remake rights, or rather not taken, but borrowed them from Warner Brothers for the similar awesome Godzilla movie and the, as I said at the start of this episode, recently debuted Godzilla King of the Monsters, because Warner Brothers has the rights to Godzilla. So, when Legendary announced that besides Kong Skull Island, they wanted to do a crossover film, Universal had to legally give Legendary permission to move Kong Skull Island's distribution work to Warner Brothers. So, legally, even though Universal owns the main rights to King Kong, Kong Skull Island and the subsequent Kong Godzilla movie is going to be done by Legendary Pictures and Warner Brothers. Again, this is an excellent case of everybody working together for everybody's benefit. So, this means that Cooper Estate retains publishing rights for the content they claim, which is the original novelization and comic book serialization done based off that novel, which they've done further limited series adaptations of that novel at other publishing companies since the original Gold Key, as well as some illustrated novels and a musical stage play in Australia that eventually premiered on Broadway. As well as various other comic books, basically continuing the story of the original novelization. Everything they can get at this point, which is fine for them. If the stories are good, great. If they're bad, well, hopefully they'll die off and people will forget about them. So, that means RKO, whose rights consisted only of the original film and its direct sequel, has had its film library acquired by Ted Turner in 1986 via his company Turner Entertainment, which I misspoke and said earlier Universal got the rights to it. I'm sorry, I confused Universal with Turner Entertainment. Turner Entertainment then merged his company into Time Warner, which is now referred to as Warner Media, which means Warner Brothers owns the rights to those two films today, although the copyright over the entire RKO Films library is still held by RKO Pictures LLC. So, the studio RKO isn't making any new films, however, there is a small company that exists essentially just to protect the copyrights they still have. However, Warner Brothers, as I said, owns the distribution rights to those original Kong films. Which means we're only left with the question of Dino De Laurentiis and his DDL company, whose rights were only limited in their 1976 remake, did do a sequel in 1986 called King Kong Lives, although they still needed Universal's permission to do so due to how legally entangled the movie rights were. Today, most of DDL's film library is owned by Studio Canal, which includes rights to these two films and the domestic North American rights in this case. To that 1976 King Kong film still remain with the film's original distributor, Paramount Pictures. So, it's basically a very weird case of, when it's all said and done, folks, Universal, Warner Media, aka Time Warner, due to them owning Turner Entertainment, and Studio Canal, as long as, and Paramount, and the Cooper Estate, all own pieces of King Kong. So depending on what you're doing with King Kong, you're going to have to call one of five different people and their legal team. Now, whatever happened to Toho and their two films, they produced King Kong vs. Godzilla and King Kong Escapes. Well, Toho still owns the rights to those two films because they did legally license it from RKO before all the rigmarole and lawsuits started. However, subsequent King Kong films featuring their altered in size and power version of King Kong have not really happened. Toho made the two films within 5 years and created a Mechanikong version similar to the iconic Mecha Godzilla, and has basically sat on it ever since. So, you know, mostly because Toho knows Kong's legally goofy, and in fact, their own attempts at doing a remake of the original King Kong vs. Godzilla, well, when the studio realized that their initial licensing rights for the movie did not cover remakes, and that they would have had to get licensing all over again, and it not going super smoothly, they decided, eh, screw it. So, technically, if you want to count the two Toho films, that's six people own pieces of King Kong. And why? Because the grand moral of the story is, always back up any legal documents you have. I don't care how small and insignificant it may seem. If you create something and it makes money, copyright it. Get your legal documentation that proves you have the copyright. Make backups, make electronic backups, make paper backups. Keep the paper backups in a different physical location from your original paper copies. Anytime you sell any kind of rights, distribution rights, film adaptation rights, television adaptation rights, Broadway musical adaptation rights, comic book adaptation rights, video game adaptation rights, any kind of, hey, I'm going to let somebody else play with my property, do the same thing. Get paper copy. Make multiple paper copies you keep in other locations. electronicize it so you have even further backups. It can, you know, in a snap, be sent off to anybody that doubts that this exists. Learn from Marion C. Cooper, because if he could have gone back and looked at how things can be done and what could and what was going to happen, and he had had his backup documents that he could get to when he needed them, potentially he could have been the sole owner of King Kong, or rather his estate, since Marion has not been with us for decades. So, there's your great moral for the day. All my entertainment buddies, all my folks that run awesome YouTube channels and have created characters for those YouTube channels, all my novelist friends, anybody creating independent films, get your copyrights, get your copies of your copyrights, protect your butt. And anytime you mess around with somebody else for adaptation or distribution use, hire a very good lawyer that specializes in copyright and entertainment law and make sure they know exactly what paperwork set is saying and that it is not going to screw you over. I'm not picking sides in any of this. Except the Universal versus Nintendo thing. In that case, I'm sorry. Universal was being a dick. I'm not saying that Donkey Kong in its original arcade version did not have inspiration from King Kong. But Universal knew legally they weren't the people that were potentially being robbed by this similarity. All the other legal rights battles, not really a case of good guy, bad guy. Case of lack of documentation and understanding about who is getting what rights. The current Legendary MonsterVerse, being done wonderfully. Universal, Warner Brothers, Legendary, they're all working together and they're making a beautiful product. Series of beautiful products. One big shared universe. Which, you know what? I think that's going to be my next rant. I think we're going to rant about shared universe eye. And crossovers. And metaverses. And omniverses. What is an omniverse? Well, get ready, folks. I'm going to throw that one at you. That's going to be next time. And yes, I'm going to take some people to tasks because I'm not just going to discuss what a shared universe is, but I'm going to discuss, more importantly, that some people really need to not do a shared universe because shared universe has become a fad. And if you don't understand how to do it right, gonna have a bad time. See you later, folks. And please, if you watch this video, comment on it. If you like the video, share it. Let's get the word out. Roulette Productions and Dangerous Ideas is still here. Also, I promise, very soon, for those of you who do read the articles on RouletteProductions.com, that I will go back to reviewing. I have not forgotten my promise to cover further Dragon Quest games. I have not forgotten that there is a lot more IDW Ghostbusters comics. In fact, I have trade paperback for the last Ghostbusters series, Crossing Over, and once I thumb through this a few times to make sure I have a good solid impression, and yes, folks, for those who vaguely follow the IDW product and have not researched this trade paperback. It does, in fact, include... the last Ghostbusters annual that was made just before the Crossing Over series. And thus, thankfully, IDW does this wonderfully. You can collect the trade paperbacks and not miss out on things like annuals, because, well, not every company does that. They like to let a lot of one-shots slip by. IDW cares more for that. Speaking of IDW, I can promise you, as a member of the Cult of Cornette, I will be purchasing IDW's comic book miniseries based off Jim Cornette's many great ring stories chronicling decades of wrestling history. And that one, in a rare case for comic book stuff, I'm probably going to do as a video review, because, hey, Cornette is the king of wrestling podcasts, and that means I'm going to go audio. Yes, there'll be some video mixed in because these are video reviews, but it is not going to be written. We are talking about it, just like Cornette talks about his stuff. So, look forward to the future. Please be patient with me, as unlike your bigger YouTube channels or bigger comic book video game reviewing websites, this is all being done by two guys who unfortunately have day jobs and family and friend obligations, so we cannot produce content as quickly as some people. We simply cannot upload every day. I'm hoping to at least get back to a once a week schedule between the website column and these video reviews. Certainly, if there's anybody else out there who would like to get some of their videos on the Roulette Productions channel, or even do some cross-advertising, crossover work. Hey, like I was mentioning before about shared universes, it's all coming tied around. Please, feel free to contact us, myself, my buddy, Rich, or Jaime, or whichever pen name you prefer to use when referring to him. Let us know, because we are willing to work with people for everybody's benefit. Just like Universal, Warner Brothers, and Legendary Pictures. Bringing it all around, folks. It's all one big circle. For now, though, pew! Peace, love, and enjoy your entertainment. The dangerous ideas will keep coming, but so is the positivity. Constructive criticism is king. I may hashtag that later. Now, go eat some good food. Go watch a classic movie. Entertainment is awesome.